In the 50s, he says that Pakistan's curriculum should be aligned with its national ideology. He does this in the 50s. Now, what happens when you have a military dictator, they get to choose, for example, who's in the Ministry of Education. Remember back in the days of Musharraf, he actually had a former DGISI as the Minister of Education. You know how effective that must have been in terms of producing fine quality education coming out of Pakistan schools. Not only are they able to do that, they're also able to exercise considerable control over Pakistan's media. It is true that Pakistan has a very diverse private media these days, but Pakistan's media, I don't know what the European counterparts are, but when I look at someone like Amir Liaquat, I think of him as sort of like Oprah Winfrey, David Duke of the Ku Klux Klan, and maybe a televangelist, right? I mean, just really the worst human being wrapped up in infotainment. And he does things like gives out children as gifts. Right? He actually had a contest where you could win a child. Oprah just gives you a car. He gives you a child. I mean, you can't make this shit up. If you try, it writes itself. So,
is he a TV person?
Yes, he is. And the old ladies love him. I mean, he's like the Dr. Oz of Pakistan. I don't like Dr. Oz either, because he's all the time selling these ridiculous, you know, green tea melts belly fat, grow a tail if you, you know, drink cacao. So he's just like Dr. Oz, but an evil Dr. Oz. Dr. Oz is just a charlatan. This guy is evil. For example, if whenever there's an Ahmadiyya slaughter, these will be one of the clowns that say, well, of course, Ahmadiyyas are wajibul qatl, which means liable to be killed. I mean, this is an actual conversation that happens on Pakistan's media. So when people talk about Pakistan's media being free, freedom is not always good, but they're not really free. They self-police, they self-monitor. It's not uncommon when people give an interview to these so-called talk shows that someone will approach them afterwards and say, well, you know, you should really be careful saying what you say. I had my own experience, actually, which I was flabbergasted by. I was doing an interview on CNBC, and the very nice presenter, she said to me, why can't you be a partner to us like China? I said, oh, that's a great question. You mean not support you in any war? Give you loans instead of aid, and engage in development projects that mostly help us and not you? She cuts me off, and she went to a commercial break, and she said, you can't talk like this about China. I said, well, then don't ask me stupid questions like this about China, because that's exactly what China is. So I thought that was really interesting that they were even, this is CNBC, right? This is a private television channel. So even she was sensitive to what was said about China. And of course, the biggest myth about China being Pakistan's best friend is a really important myth of the Pakistan army. I mean, if people understood that China's not Pakistan's best friend, it would be a big problem, I think, for many of the myths that they put forward. And then afterwards, we began discussing something anodyne, like my liking of chupli kebabs. I mean, that's where the conversation went, China, US to chupli kebabs. You didn't even want to risk, you know, pissing me off again.